Hi, my name is Paweł Parol. I'm solutions architect from CodiLime. In this video, we'll try to explain what CNI is and how it works. The term CNI, Container Network Interface, appears in numerous tutorials and other publicly available educational content, for example, about Kubernetes. As many people recognize CNI primarily as a part of the Kubernetes ecosystem. While this is basically correct, it is important to understand that CNI is actually something autonomous. It is not used exclusively by Kubernetes, but also by other container orchestration platforms and container runtimes. However, CNI is often discussed so briefly that it is difficult to understand what is really behind it. We hope after watching this video, you will never again wonder what is this CNI all about. So what is CNI then? To understand this, let's look at the following example. As you may know, containers are run on the host operating system thanks to a container runtime. This is software that is responsible for the proper handling of the process. It includes taking the appropriate container image, mount point preparation, setting various parameters, assigning C groups, providing container isolation by using various types of namespaces, etc. And finally, starting the container. Usually, we also want to be able to connect to such a container. First from the host, then from other nodes in the cluster, and in most cases also from the outside world. So we need to attach the container to network. And to do this, the container runtime calls one or more dedicated applications that are responsible for it. These are called plugins. What exactly are they doing? For example, they can create an interface inside a container and create a link between the host and the container network namespace. They can then assign an IP address to the container, define its default gateway, populate routes in its routing table, etc. Plugins are also used to append the appropriate network configuration to the host as new containers arrive. This may include creating new interfaces, adding IP addresses and routing, but also injecting appropriate rules into IP tables. In order to make the whole process repeatable and efficient, the CNI project was created. The project is hosted by the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, which is a community supporting the development of open source cloud native software. In short, the idea of the CNI project is to provide a standard method for attaching a container to a network and for applying the network configuration that is required for this purpose, both to the host and inside the container. So what exactly does the CNI project provide in this context? First, the CNI specification, defining how container runtimes and plugins should talk to each other. Then reference plugin implementations, and finally a collection of libraries and tools. Now let's look at what the CNI specification is. First, it defines how to describe the network configuration to which the containers are to be connected. When such a configuration is ready, the container runtime knows what sequence of plugins to use to get the desired effect. And with what parameters they must be called. The CNI specification also defines a protocol for communicating with the plugins. Sometimes plugins can trigger other plugins to perform certain tasks. And finally, the plugins inform the container runtime of what they have done. The types of response message are also defined within the specification. After this brief overview, let's get into the details. How to define the network configuration to be applied to containers? As you can see, the JSON format is used for this purpose. We start by indicating the version of the CNI specification that we want to use. Then we define the name of the network we are creating. And that was relatively easy. Now it's time for the most important part. In the plugins array, we list all plugins that will be called to create a given network configuration. The order in the array corresponds to the order in which the plugins will be called. This means that each container that we want to connect to this network will be configured by all the plugins on the list. They must be called by the container runtime one by one. Plugins are referenced using the type key each time, followed by the plugin's name. In the example shown here, the network configuration is made up of three plugins. They are called Bridge, Tuning, and My Plugin 1. Also note that the Bridge plugin calls one more plugin called DHCP. For each plugin, we can define a set of parameters. As you can imagine, we use different keys for this purpose. You already know one of them, its type. This is a mandatory field. There's also a group of keys that plugins commonly use. These are well-known optional keys. Different plugins will always understand them in the same way, as they are assumed to have a standard meaning. There are also keys with a specific meaning. This is information telling the container runtime that when calling a given plugin whose configuration contains such a key, it must treat it in a specific, strictly defined way. An example here is a key called capabilities. We will show you how it can be used later on. Each plugin can also have its own defined keys, specific to itself. Plugin authors are generally free to choose the names for these keys and then implement the corresponding logic within the plugin's code. However, please note that some names are reserved and cannot be used for this purpose. After the full network configuration is ready, the container runtime analyzes it and invokes the plugins one by one according to what has been defined. Each plugin receives on its standard input only the part of the configuration that is addressed to it. But this is not all. You still have to tell it what action to perform. CNI version 1.0 defines four actions, like creating a configuration, deleting it, checking its status, and additionally verifying the CNI version supported by the plugin. Moreover, the plugin also needs to know which container to configure and exactly which interface inside it. If a plugin is supposed to call another plugin, it needs to know where to look for the required binaries. The container runtime can also pass to it additional configuration parameters. Here's an example of how a plugin can be called. As mentioned before, the plugin config derived from the network configuration is passed to the plugin on its standard input, like you can see here. The plugin is supposed to perform the add operation. It also receives the container ID assigned by the runtime, the path to the container network namespace, and the name of the interface inside the container to which the given operation applies. After completing the task, the plugin sends a response about its status. If it was successful, a success message is sent. If not, the plugin sends an error message to the container runtime. The format of the success message is strictly defined. It always contains information about created or modified interfaces, IP addresses assigned to them, routes configured inside a container, and DNS-related information. The error message, in turn, contains both general and detailed information about the type of problem that occurred. Now let's look at the complete example of how plugins are invoked by the container runtime based on a given network configuration. The first plugin on the list is invoked exactly as specified in the network configuration. The plugin responds with the success message that you can see on the right. Then the second plugin is invoked just like the first. Here, however, there's an additional pref result key that contains the message sent by the previous plugin. This is required by the CNI specification for add operation, and it applies to every plugin on the list except the first. In the case of the tuning plugin, you can observe another interesting thing, namely the capabilities key in the network configuration is replaced with the runtime config section with the appropriate content when the plugin is called. This is a way to pass dynamic information to the plugin. In this case, it is the MAC address value. And finally, the third plugin is called, which is the last one. Again, the pref result key contains the success response from the previous plugin, which is the second plugin in this case. The CNI project is not just a specification. As mentioned earlier, it also provides implementations of reference plugins. Among them, we can distinguish three groups. The first group is called an interface plugins group. The main task of this type of plugin is to create an interface of a specific type inside a container. Then we have plugins from the IP address management group. These are primarily responsible for assigning an IP address to the previously created interface. And there are also plugins called chain plugins. These perform additional network configuration inside the container and on the host if needed. Basically, they do not create new interfaces. They operate on those created by an interface plugin. Now let's do an overview of the plugins available in each group. So let's start with the interface plugins. The bridge plugin creates a Linux bridge instance on the host and attaches a container to it using a vifper. Multiple containers can be attached to the same bridge. The point-to-point plugin creates a vifper with one end placed inside a container and the other end pinned directly to the host network namespace without using any bridge. Another plugin called MacVillain creates a Mac VLAN sub interface on the given network device on the host and moves it to the container. Multiple Mac VLAN sub interfaces can enslave the same physical interface on the host. Each such sub interface has its own MAC address configured. The IP VLAN plugin works similarly to Mac VLAN, except that it uses sub interfaces of the IP VLAN type, which, unlike MacVillain, use the same MAC address. And the host device plugin, on the other hand, does not create any SAP interfaces. It just moves a network device from the network from the host network namespace to the container network namespace. There are also loopback and VLAN plugins. The first sets the state of the container loopback interface to app, and the second creates a VLAN interface inside a container. The plugins mentioned so far are related to Linux operating system, but there are also plugins for Windows. The WinBridge plugin creates a bridge for attaching containers to it, while the WinOverlay plugin connects the container to the VXLAN overlay network. As for IPOM plugins, there are three implementations available. The host local plugin allocates IP addresses to containers out of a specified address range. The uniqueness of IP addresses on the host is ensured by maintaining a local database of addresses. The DHCP plugin in turn runs a daemon on the host to make a DHCP request to a DHCP server running on your network, for example, on behalf of containers. Such a daemon takes care that DHCP leases are periodically renewed. The last option is to use a static IP address management plugin, which is which just allocates static IP addresses to containers. The third group are the chained plugins. Here we have a tuning plugin, which can change some system controls of an existing interface and also allows you to configure various interface attributes inside a container, like MAC address, permissions mode, or MTU. And to apply bandwidth limitation to the container interface, you can use a bandwidth plugin. The next two plugins configure the host IP tables. The firewall plugin allows forwarding traffic to or from the given container, while the port mapping plugin maps selected ports on the host to the container's ports. Another two plugins are virtual routing and forwarding and source-based routing. The first creates a VRF instance in the plugin network namespace and assigns to it the interface previously created by the interface plugin. And the second configures source-based routing inside a container. For more detailed information on the operation and configuration of all the above-mentioned plugins, you can refer to the official documentation available at the following link. The reference plugins offered by the CNI project are typically not installed on Kubernetes clusters as primary networking solutions. Instead, third-party solutions are used. This can be based on reference plugins, but are usually more powerful and advanced. They are responsible not only for attaching containers to the network with a single node in the cluster, like reference plugins do, but also for communication between nodes, as well as consistent network configuration throughout the cluster. It is worth mentioning that their functionality often goes beyond what is covered by the CNI. For example, they can provide Kubernetes network policy implementations or various observability features. Third-party plugins can use many different network technologies and solutions underneath, such as VXLAN, BGP, eBPF, OVS, SRIOV, and many more. Many such solutions are available today, including, for example, Flannel, Calico, KubeOVN, Cilium, Tungsten Fabric, WaveNet, or Malthus. To choose the most suitable solution for your Kubernetes cluster, simply visit their websites to find out more.